If you have your Bibles, take them and turn to the Old Testament, to one of the minor prophets, the book of Hosea. Hosea, chapter 4, verse 16. Hosea is the book right after the book of Daniel. Hosea, chapter 4, verse 16. And it says, "For Israel slideth back as a backsliding heifer. Now the Lord will feed them as a lamb in a large place." Now look at Hosea 11, verse 7. And it says, "And my people are bent to backsliding from me, though they call them to the Most High, none at all would exalt him." And then look at chapter 14, verse 4. It says, "And I will heal their backsliding." Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, tonight, Lord, we rejoice with the testimonies of men and women and teenagers who have claimed that they have been born again by your Spirit. Lord, we rejoice at the miracle of salvation. God, I pray tonight that tonight will be a special night, that, Lord, you will literally sink a stake in the ground, Lord, as a marking spot, that tonight was a turning point. I pray, God, for every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, every teenager. God, I pray, no matter who they are, no matter where they're from, the first thing I pray, dear God, is right now simply that you would reveal to every single person their eternal condition in your eyes. God, reveal to every person here tonight, whether they are on their way to heaven or whether they're on their way to hell, God, reveal to them whether or not they've truly been born again by the Spirit of God. And God, for those who are here who've never truly been born again, I pray, God, you would take this message tonight and you would use it to convict their heart and their soul and their spirit. You would draw them to salvation tonight. And God, for those who are here tonight who are born again, I pray, God, you would show them the danger of cooling off, the danger of leaving their first love. God, show them that by our very nature we are prone to backsliding, that, God, we must work and we must reach out to you and draw near to you to keep from falling away. I pray, Heavenly Father, you will speak to our hearts. And for those who are here tonight, God, who are born again, set their hearts on fire, God, to live all out for you, unashamed and unafraid. God, as we start the third week, I pray, God, your will be done. Give us a vision of what we need to do, how long we need to stay. God, take control, speak to our hearts, save souls and change lives. That is my prayer. And dear God, in just a few brief moments when I complete this sermon, and once again we stand to our feet and sing that invitation hymn, "Just As I Am," without one plea, I pray, God, we'll see men and women and teenagers and boys and girls leave their seed and leave their sin to come to Christ to be really saved before it's everlastingly too late. I pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. The most important question you'll ever hear is this: if you were to die tonight, what would happen? If you were to die tonight, do you know for sure that your soul would go to heaven? You say, "William, I think I would go to heaven." Well, dear friend, thinking's not good enough. You need to know that you've been born again. When you say, "Well, I think I'm saved," and I would ask you this question: why do you think you're saved? Across America, everybody thinks they're saved because everybody thinks that we live in a Christian nation. A lot of men think they're saved because they're an American. This is a Christian nation. I'm an American, therefore I must be a Christian. We have a lot of folks that by their denomination, I'm a Baptist or a Methodist or a Catholic or an Episcopalian, I've joined the church, therefore I must be a Christian. But Jesus Christ made it very clear. He said, "You must be born again." There must be a day in your life when God supernaturally changes you on the inside. It is caused by simply, number one, you must be aware that you have sinned against God, that you are a rebel against God. The Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." I can stand before you and call you a sinner and be unashamed about that, because God calls you a sinner. God says everyone has sinned. The Bible says there's none that doeth good, no, not one. The Bible says all of our righteousness and our good works and our good life is nothing more than filthy rags in the eyes of a holy God. A man must come to terms with God. He must understand that God is the creator, he is the created. God is holy and perfect, and without sin, we are sinners by our very nature. We have willfully rebelled against God. And the Bible says, God has declared the wages of sin, the punishment for sin, is death and hell. Because you and I are sinners against the Most High God, the Bible says our souls are condemned to hell. There's absolutely nothing we can do to save ourselves. But a holy God is also a loving God, and he wants to save us, but a holy God must keep his word. He must punish our sin. So what God did was he sent a sacrificial lamb. He sent a substitute. He sent his son. And Jesus Christ has taken the sin of the world, and he has gone to a cross, and he has died paying our sin debt. And the Bible says God gives every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, every teenager a choice to make. You can choose life or you can choose death. You can choose heaven or you can choose hell. You can choose to come to Jesus Christ and give him your life and let him pay your sin debt. Or, sir, you can reject Jesus and you can pay your own sin debt and go to a place called hell. My friend, the greatest opportunity you'll ever have is to be born again by the Holy Spirit of the living God. And Jesus Christ said, I've saved you not only to go to heaven, but I've saved you for a relationship, to live with me and to fellowship with me and to honor me and to be my son, my child on planet Earth. And the Bible says that once we are born again, we have the Spirit of the living God. But the Bible says we are prone to backsliding. We are prone to fall away from God, not to lose our salvation, but we're falling away from fellowship. You know why, friend? Because once we are saved, our soul is saved, but our flesh and bone body is not saved. Our flesh and bone body is still decaying and dying. Our flesh and bone body is still in rebellion against God. And the Bible says the soul wars against the flesh. The spirit and the flesh fight against each other for domination. And I'm telling you, friends, this old flesh is strong. And so if you're not on guard, you'll slide away from God. You'll lose that fire. You'll lose that enthusiasm. In fact, the ugliest word in all the Bible is the word backsliding. Nobody wants to be called a backslider. I was going door to door witnessing one day, and I met a lady, and I asked her, I said, ma'am, are you born again? Have you been saved by the Spirit of the living God? And she said, yes, I have been born again. And she gave me her testimony. And I said, well, ma'am, if you're saved, are you living all out for God? And she dropped her eyes and looked at the floor. And she said, no, to be honest, I'm not living all out for God. And I said, well, ma'am, you know what the Bible calls you? The Bible calls you a backslider. And she said, no, don't call me a backslider. Call me anything but a backslider. But yet, friends, that is the very word God uses to speak to someone who's been born again by the Spirit of God, but they've left their first love. They've cooled off. You see, a backslider is not a hypocrite. The word hypocrite is used 28 times in the New Testament. And in every case, the word hypocrite refers to a lost man. When Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, or the Sadducees, or the Herodians, he called them hypocrites. But he never considered them saved. He never considered them born again. You see, the word backslider does not mean hypocrite. The word hypocrite means a pretender, a person who is pretending to be saved, a lost church member, somebody that acts saved, that says they're saved, they maybe even look saved, but inside their heart they've not been born again. Those folks would be classified by God as hypocrites, as actors, as pretenders. But a backslider is not a hypocrite. A backslider is not somebody who's lost his salvation. We have a lot of folks that believe that if you backslide, you lose your salvation. But my friends, that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches, friends, if we could lose our salvation when we backslide, we'd all be lost, friends, because we all sin every day of our life. No, friends, the Bible says when you come to Jesus Christ, he gives you everlasting life. Now, how long is everlasting? Everlasting is everlasting. And the Bible says it's not us that does the saving anyway. It is the sovereign God that does the saving. And Jesus Christ, those that my Father have put in my hand, I'll never let go. So a person who is a backslider is not somebody that loses their salvation. No, a backslider is a saved person, somebody who's really been born again by the Spirit of God. But that person has cooled off. They've quit serving God with a hot heart. Perhaps they've fallen into sin. And they no longer have that relationship with God, that fiery that frequency of really serving God and praying and living all out for God. You see, friends, when you look in the Bible, a classic example of a backslider would be this man called Demas. In 2 Timothy 4:10, it says, "For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica." You see, Paul and Demas worked together for the Lord. Man, they were on fire for God. They went door to door. They won people to Jesus. They probably had revival services. Maybe Demas did the singing, and Paul did the preaching, but they worked hand in hand serving God. They were on fire for God. They lifted their hands and praised God. Man, they loved God with all their heart. But one day the Bible says Demas stopped all that. He left Paul. He stopped serving God. He went back to Thessalonica because the Bible says he loved the things of the world. Now that's what a backslider is. And I can just visualize Demas and Paul working together. But there came a day when the world began to tug at his heart. The lust of the world, the ease of the world, the comfort of the world. And Demas made a decision to leave the work of God and go back to where the bright lights were. That's what a backslider is. A backslider is a saved man who's really been born by the Spirit of God, but for some reason he takes his eyes off God, he looks at the bright lights of the world, that fire in his heart cools off, and he stops serving God with all of his heart, and he'll start falling back into that sin. And I want to tell you, friends, our churches are filled up, number one, with lost people. We are filled up with lost people who've never been born again. But the tragic fact is, the folks in our churches who are saved, 85% of them are backslid. They've lost their fire. They've lost their fervency. They've lost that real, that first love of really living all out for God. And I want to tell you, friends, Demas did not backslide all of a sudden. I mean, it wasn't just an instantaneous backsliding. You see, backsliding is a process. Backsliding is something that takes a little time. You gradually get away from God. It's like that story you've heard about putting the frog in the hot water. You know, you put him in a pot of boiling water, and that frog will jump out. But you put him in a pot of cold water, and you turn the heat up and let that water get hot slowly, and that frog will stay there and die. See, that's the way it is with sin in your life. Nobody wants to backslide from God. See, backsliding is a process. You slowly, your heart cools off, and you inch by inch get away from the Lord. You see, the word backsliding tells you it's a process. It's not back jumping. It's not back falling. It's backsliding. It's a process, and the Bible teaches it starts in the heart. In 2 Timothy 4:10, it says, "For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world." You see, backsliding starts when you love the wrong things. When you love the wrong things, you're taking your love away from God. You see, God is a jealous God. God is a God that wants your full, undivided attention. And when we take our eyes away from God, we start moving away from God. We start backsliding. We start cooling off. You see, backsliding is a process when you start loving the wrong things. I mean, ladies, remember when you first got married? Remember how that you got married and your husband just loved you? Man, he'd go to the office. He'd call you two or three times. Said, "Just want to hear your voice." Always wanting to hold your hand, always wanting to be around you. Just couldn't have enough time with you. He loved you so much. Remember when you were courting? He'd come over on a date. You never were ready on time, were you? And he sat in that living room waiting on you. He sat there, but he never complained at all. You come down, you had that pretty little dress on, and you were so sparkling and charming, and you came in and you said, "Oh, I'm so sorry I'm late. I'm so slow. I didn't mean to make you wait." And you said, "Oh, it's all right." You went out to the car, and man, you opened up the door on her side and just escorted her in that car. Man, you were just so proud to be with her, just loved her, had such a tenderness. But how is it today? Oh, you get up in the morning, on Sunday morning, to go to church. And man, he's huffing around. He said, "Listen, you're taking all day to get dressed. You must be the slowest woman God ever made. Will you get out of that bathroom and let me get in there for a few moments? I'm in a hurry." He's fussing and fuming. I mean, he goes out in the car. He won't even wait on you. He starts beating on the horn, honk, honk. And you finally get dressed, and you come out there and get in the car. And man, he doesn't open the door for you anymore. You've got to open your own door. And you slide in. And before you can get that door closed, he's already halfway to the church. Now, ladies, you remember how it used to be, and you remember how it is today? Sometimes we leave that first love. Sometimes our hearts cool off, and we don't have that closeness and that vibrance that we had at one time. The same thing can happen spiritually. I mean, a guy comes down here and gives his heart to Jesus.
Man, he's on fire. Remember how it was when you first got saved? Man, you couldn't hear enough good Bible preaching. You couldn't hear enough good gospel singing. Man, you couldn't wait from Sunday night to Wednesday night to Sunday morning. You wish they had church every day of the week. You just wanted to be in the presence of God, and you loved God. You were on fire for God. But you know how it is now? Man, it's all you can do to drag yourself out of bed on Sunday morning. Man, you don't read your Bible. You don't pray. You don't witness to anybody. You know why? You've left your first love. You've cooled off. You don't have that fire, and the Bible calls that backsliding. The Bible says when you lose that first love, now men, listen to me. You either love Jesus more tonight or you love him less tonight. There's no standing still with Jesus. My friend, every day of your life, you should be getting stronger and bolder and more courageous. Every day, you all should be getting more in the image of Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, the sad fact is tonight that some of you tonight are no more on fire for God than you were when you first got saved. Some of you here tonight, you don't read your Bible any more each day than you did when you first got saved. Some of you don't witness any more tonight than you did when you first got saved. Some of you don't give any more money today to God than you gave when you first got saved. My friends, that's called backsliding. You say you are either growing in grace and knowledge or you're backsliding. There's no standing still. And when that fire leaves your heart, men, when you aren't excited about the things of God, when you aren't getting better and stronger and more courageous and more like Jesus, the Bible calls that backsliding. And sir, that's a sin in the eyes of a holy God. Here's a sermon from a hymn book. We come to church and sing Sweet Hour of Prayer, but then we're content with meaningless prayers at mealtime. We come and sing Onward Christian Soldier, then we have to be drafted for Christian service. We come and sing Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing, but we don't use the tongue we have to speak for Jesus. We come and sing Showers of Blessing, yet one drop of rain will keep us out of God's house. We come and sing Blessed Be the Tie That Binds, but the least little problem at church breaks our friendship with other believers. We come and sing, Serve the Lord with Gladness, yet we gripe about what we have to do for the Lord. We come and sing, I love to tell the story, yet we've never told our buddy on the job that story. We come and sing, We're Marching to Zion, yet we sleep during Sunday school. We come and sing, Throw Out the Lifeline, yet we spend more time throwing out the fishing line. We come and sing, Turn Your Eyes Toward Jesus, yet we spend 90% of our time turning our eyes to the TV set. Do you have the seeds of backsliding in your life? Are you on fire for God? Because I'm telling you, when God saved you, He saved you for fellowship. He saved you as a testimony of His love. He saved you to join God's army. And men, it is a sin against God to be on the sidelines when the war is going on. God says you must come, put on the whole armor of God, serve me with a hot heart. God says, I don't want you to be lukewarm. I want you to be hot or cold, but that lukewarm bunch makes me sick. And that's what a backslider is. He's a man who has been saved by the grace of God, but he doesn't appreciate it enough to go on with God. God says that's backsliding. And I want to tell you what, friends, when you're a backslider, that doesn't mean that necessarily you have to go out in the world and go back to drinking and running around and living like the devil. I'm convinced that Sunday after Sunday, we have folks in our churches that are backslid. Folks come to church, they're there physically, but their mind is a million miles away. Their heart is a million miles away. They're there sitting in their place because they feel an obligation, but they don't have the Spirit of God. They're not really tuned in to the things of God because their heart is not lined up with God's heart. And God calls that backsliding. Well, how does that happen? As I told you, the reason people backslide, number one, because of our carnal nature. We have a saved soul, but we have a lost body. And they war against each other. And my friends, it's like this. Suppose you had two dogs in the back of your yard. Suppose you had two nice dogs. One was a white dog. One was a black dog. And suppose you fed that black dog the best dog food that money could buy. You took him to the vet. You exercised him. You gave him plenty of water. You treated him like a king. But the white dog, you starved. You didn't take care of. You let him stay out there by himself in the cold weather. You didn't give him enough water. And then after about a month of this kind of treatment, you put the black dog and the white dog into a fight. Which dog would win? Well, the black dog would win. That's the way it is between your soul and your flesh. The flesh is the black dog. The soul is the white dog. If you're constantly feeding the black dog, if you're constantly feeding the flesh with your television and your magazines and your videos and the things of the world, my friends, you cannot expect to have a spiritual victory when you feed the flesh and starve the spirit that God has given you. And we are backsliders by our very nature because of this flesh that draws us away from God. The Bible says in Hosea 11:7, "And my people are bent to backsliding from me." But also you people backslide because they neglect their Christian exercises. You see, my friends, just like your body needs exercise, your spirit needs exercise. You need to go out there and you need to exercise your spirit. Well, how do you exercise your spirit? Well, it takes the deep knee bends of prayer. It takes the sit-ups of Bible study. It takes the laps of soul winning. Now, man, I've learned this a long time ago, and you hear me. You cannot grow as a Christian without putting some effort in the things of God. And I've learned this, the one thing you can do that will grow you faster than anything else is to tell people how to be saved. There's something supernatural. When a man stands up for God, God will stand up for him. When a man will step out there on that water, God will let him walk on that water, buddy. When a man will be courageous, when he'll have that hot heart, when he'll be a hero for Jesus, I'm telling you, God will bless that man and strengthen that man and give him supernatural strength that he didn't even know he has right now. My friends, you need to witness. You need to tell people about Jesus. You need to memorize the Bible. You need to memorize a verse every day of your life. David said, "I hide the word of God in my heart so I'll not sin against God." Hide the word of God in your heart, because even when Jesus was tempted by the devil, he defended himself by quoting scripture. Hide the word of God in your heart and then pray, man. I don't mean that nickel and dime stuff you do 10 seconds before you hop in bed saying, "God, forgive me my sins," and you're off to sleep. I'm talking about praying with God, buddy. I'm talking about getting along with God. I'm talking about hanging on to God till God shows up. I'm talking about asking, keep on asking, knock, and keep on knocking. I believe, friends, the reason we don't have answered prayer is God doesn't take us serious because we don't invest enough time and energy calling upon the name of the Lord. When was the last time you prayed for an hour, sir? When was the last time you prayed all night for your lost children? You see, my friends, if you really believed in prayer, you'd invest whatever time it took to hang on to God, knowing that God was going to answer you if you just have faith. So we backslide because of our carnal nature, because we neglect our exercises. But also people backslide because they fail to go deep enough with the Lord. The Bible says in 1 Peter 1, verse 5, "Add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But if you lack these things, you are blind and cannot see afar off, and have forgotten you were purged from your old sin." God says, listen, if you're not growing in grace and knowledge, you're backsliding. Every day of your life, you ought to be adding to your faith, adding virtue, adding godliness, adding temperance. Every day, you should become stronger and bolder and more courageous and more like Jesus, friend. And the reason we get backslid is we don't grow. You see, most Christians are like a wasp. Did you know that a wasp is bigger when it's born than at any time in its life? Did you know that? That's the way a lot of Christians are. They're the biggest, the closest to God when they first get saved, and the longer they're saved, the further they get away from God. I told a group the other night, the average guy, when he gets saved, when he really gets born again, he's got a backslide just so he can fellowship with everybody else in the church, because we live so far away from God. I'm telling you, friends, being a born-again believer is a radical thing. It's not some little namby-pamby religious thing, buddy. It is a radical thing. It is a fanatical thing. It is an all-out thing. It is a sold-out thing. I'm telling you, those folks that followed Jesus Christ were cast into the lion's den. They were sawed in half. They were tortured. They were terrified. They gave their lives because they had committed their lives to Christ, and the life on earth counted for absolutely nothing. And what we do today is we come and God saves us, and then we give God the leftovers of our life. We spend our money like we want to spend it. We live our lives like we want to live it. And if there's any money left, any time left, we throw it to God like a bone to an old dog. But I'm telling you, friends, God deserves the very, very best. And when we neglect that, when we fail to grow, when we fail to become everything God wants us to be, that's called backsliding. And that, my friends,
is a sin. The fourth reason people become backslidden is they are influenced, listen, teenage friend, by the wrong crowd. Listen to what 1 Corinthians 15:33 says. It says, "Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners." Do you know what that means? That means you lay down with dogs, you're going to get fleas. It means you hang around the dope crowd, you'll become part of the dope crowd. You hang around the liquor crowd, you'll be part of the liquor crowd. Friend, you don't have enough strength to resist that. The Bible doesn't say resist sin. The Bible says flee from sin, because you've got this old carnal nature. It is weak. The Bible says our heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it, buddy? We have a sin nature. We are weak. And the Bible says if we get in the presence of sin, we hang around the wrong crowd, go the wrong places, you'll wake up one day, sir, and you'll be so far away from God, you can't even remember He existed. And that's why folks get backslid. That carnal nature, they don't do their exercises, they're influenced by the wrong crowd, they don't go deep enough with God. Well, what does it matter? I mean, if you're saved and you're going to heaven, if you've been born again, what difference does it matter whether you're backslid or not? Well, because of how God deals with backsliding. You see, the Bible says God chastens the backslider. My friends, the Bible says in Hebrews 12, 5 and 6, it says this, "And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. No chastening for the present seems to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby." You know what that means? When you, as a born-again believer, you have sin in your life, you have a cool heart, you back away from God and you're backslidden, let me tell you what God does, young friend. God's not going to tolerate it. God's not going to put up with that rebellion. God's not going to put up with sin. You know how God sees rebellion? God sees rebellion as the sin of witchcraft. In the eyes of a holy God, when you are backslid, when you are in rebellion against Him, He sees you just like a witch. He sees you as a Satan worshiper. He sees you somebody who loves the world more than you love Him. My friend, and God has dedicated Himself not to let you live in that position. God has dedicated Himself to chastening and scourging His children because He loves them. I want to tell you what, when Demas went back to the big city with all the bright lights and the fast cars and all the nightclubs, you think old Demas was happy? I'm willing to tell you that Demas was probably the most miserable man in Thessalonica. Because, my friends, the Bible teaches that the most miserable man on planet Earth is not a lost man. It's a saved man who's living in a backslidden condition. Because when a man who is saved lives away from God, God will chasten him. That's problems in your life. God will turn your finances upside down. God will have problems in your business or your family. God's trying to shake you to get your attention to show that you're going away from Him and to draw you back. The Bible says God will even scourge His son. That's physical illness. Friend, I'm telling you, you can bring disease and illness in your own physical body by rebelling against God. I believe there are a lot of folks today in the hospital simply because they are backslidden and in rebellion against God. And the Bible says in 1 John, there is a sin unto death. There comes a day, Christian friend, you live backslidden away from God so long, you won't come back, you won't get right. God chastens you and scourges you. There comes a time when holy God will simply sign your death certificate. He'll take you home to get you out of this place because you're such a sorry testimony. Now, I have men tell me all the time, "Well, William, I just don't believe that. I don't believe that God would scourge or chasten or even kill His children because I'm a church member and I'm backslidden, I'm living in sin, and God hasn't chastened me." Well, sir, don't be bragging about that. That just means you're lost and on your way to hell. The Bible says a man who lives in sin and God does not chasten him and does not scourge him, that means he is not a child of God. He is illegitimate and he belongs to the devil. You see, God does not whip the devil's kids. He only whips His own. And I'm here to tell you, if you live in sin and you love sin and you go on and God has not chastened you and scourged you, that is proof positive you have not been born again by the Holy Spirit. And I'm telling you, friends, you need to hear this tonight. There are some of you men, here's what happened to you. When you were a young boy, you walked down an aisle and made a profession of faith. Then when you got to be a teenager, you left church and you lived like the devil. You drank and you ran around. You went off to service and lived like the devil.
20 or 30 years lived like the devil, but somewhere down the line, you got married, your wife was a Christian, you decided to clean up your act and come back to the church house and rededicate your life. Friend, I want to tell you, you are not a backslider. Friend, you never slid up in the first place. I want to tell you, man, when you walk an aisle, no matter at what age, when you walk an aisle and really get born again, it changes your life. And it produces a love for God and a passion for God. And yes, a man can backslide, but there must be a period of living all out for God. And I want to tell you, man, I do not believe that a man can live in a backslidden condition for 20 years and God not kill him. I do not believe these testimonies I hear all the time about living 20 and 30 and 40 years away from God and then coming back and rededicating your life. Sir, you are not saved. When you walk an aisle and really get born again, God has dedicated himself to chastening and scourging the child of God. You cannot live 30 years in rebellion against God without him killing you and taking you home. And some of you men, right now, you've rededicated, but you've got nothing to rededicate to. And tonight, God wants to save your soul. God wants you to come and be born again by the Holy Spirit of God. You have a form of religion, but you don't have the Spirit of God. I tell you what, man, if you have to ask a guy if he's saved, he's probably not saved. I'm telling you, when a man is really born again, it just oozes out, buddy. It just comes out of every pore of his very being. When you get around a man who's saved, you won't talk to him about 30 seconds, and the name of Jesus will come up, because that is his very being. That is what he lives for, is to live for God. And some of you men, you come to church on Sunday, but you live for the world on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. But I'm telling you, friends, you don't have it. You don't have it. When the Spirit of God takes control, it's a 24-hour-a-day thing, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. When a man gets the Spirit of God, it produces a love and a passion for the Lord Jesus Christ. And there are some of you here tonight, you think you're backslidden, but you're just lost. You've never given your heart to Christ, and God wants to save your soul tonight. What's the cure for backsliding? Well, the Bible tells us what God wants us to do about the backsliding. God tells us in Jeremiah 3:12, "Return, thou backsliding Israel, saith the Lord, and I will not cause my anger to fall upon you." Hosea 6:1 says, "Come, let us return to the Lord, for he hath torn, and he will heal us. He hath smitten, and he will bind us." Hosea 14:4 says, "I will heal their backsliding." The answer to backsliding, return. Return to God. And my friends, to return to God does not mean rededicate your life. That's a bunch of Baptist nonsense. The way you return to God is repent. That's how you come to God in the first place to be saved. That's how you come back as a backslider. Repent. To repent means you must simply change your mind. Change your mind about sin. Change your mind about Jesus. Change your heart. Stop loving the world, sir. Love Jesus. Change your direction. Stop going the world's way. Come back to God and go God's way. Repent. That is the message of the Bible. The Bible says, "You have backslidden away from me. You are far from me, ma'am. You have sinned against a holy God." And God says, "I will chasten and scourge you, except ye repent." The Bible says, "You'll perish." And tonight there are many of you that need to come in repentance. There are many of you here tonight that have never truly been born again. And tonight God has spoken to your heart. You don't have the Spirit of God. And God wants to save your soul tonight. And there are many of you here tonight, you're saved, but you're in a backslidden condition. Oh, you're enjoying the revival. You're enjoying the singing. You get to lift your hands and praise God, but you know what? It hadn't got deep down in your soul yet. Oh, you hadn't invested any more time reading God's Word. You hadn't invested any more hours in prayer. You haven't poured out your heart in tears and prayer for a lost loved one. You haven't been burdened enough to win anybody to Christ yet. Oh, my friends, I'm telling you, you're a long way from God. And before we can have a real revival, before we can impact an entire town, an entire state, number one, we've got to have everyone who claims the name of Christ to have a right relationship with Christ, to come back from that backsliding, to be sold out on fire for God. And we need those of you here tonight who've never been born again to stop playing church, stop pretending, and come and make it real before it's everlastingly too late. I ask you at the very first of the sermon, if you were to die tonight, do you know for sure that you'd go to heaven? You say, well, I think I would. Well, let me ask you this. Why do you think you're going to heaven when you die? You say, well, when I was a young boy, a young girl, I walked down an aisle and I made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. Ma'am, that doesn't mean anything. Jesus Christ said, there are many of you who make professions with your mouth, but with your heart and your life, you're a long way from me. You say, well, I believe in Jesus. I must be saved. The Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. But the Bible says the devil believes in Jesus, sir. You see, my friends, it's not enough to have a head knowledge of Jesus. You've got to have a heart knowledge. See, some of you are going to miss heaven by about 12 inches between your head and your heart. You've got a head knowledge, but you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ. You know how you can tell? You don't have a passion for God. Your life was not changed. You walked an aisle, you prayed a prayer, but you went out and you were the same person you'd always been. And I'm here to tell you, when you meet Jesus and really are born again, it changes your life, changes your character, changes your mind, changes the way you think, changes your personality, changes the way you love. And the question is, have you been changed by the Spirit of God? Have you been born again by the Holy Spirit? If not, you need to come tonight and be saved. And there are many of you here tonight, you've really given Jesus your life, but you've been given the leftovers of your life. He saved your soul. He's going to take you to heaven, but you're treating Him pretty terrible right now. You haven't read that Bible. You haven't memorized any scripture. You haven't cried out in prayer. Oh, we're giving God just the leftovers of our life. And God calls that backsliding. My question tonight, born again believers, is this. Was there ever a day when you were more on fire for God than you are right now? Was there ever a moment when you loved Jesus more than you love Him right now? Was there ever a moment in your life when the things of God were dearer to your heart than they are right now? Friends, if there was ever a moment in your life when you were more hot about the things of God than you are tonight, then God classifies you as a backslider. And the message is repent. Come back to God. Because the Bible says if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Hallelujah. Come back to God. Let Him wipe the slate clean. Let Him purge you of that sin. Let Him set your feet on the solid rock. Let Him point your eyes toward heaven. Let Him use you to win a lost and dying world to Jesus Christ. If there was ever a day when men ought to get serious about God, it's now. If there was ever going to be a day when you were going to be God's man, a hero of the faith, sir, it needs to be now. If there was ever going to be a day when you were going to get out of that lukewarm, lazy middle and get in the hot group for God and sell out to God, it needs to be now. God is calling you to repentance. If you're here tonight and you're not born again, God calls you to repentance in order to be saved. But if you are born again, God calls you back to repent from your backsliding and let Him use you for His glory and His honor. Hallelujah. What an opportunity we have to serve the one and living true God. Let's bow our heads.